Artists and producers are rethinking not only how we make money, but where that money comes from and goes. That's why we wanted to bring together some of the brightest minds in and outside of the music industry today to talk about the changing economic landscape and look at what we might be discussing at South by Southwest in the coming years. So I'm beyond excited to introduce our awesome panelists, our moderator, Rembert Brown.
Oh, stop.
Is a senior writer at Grantland and has been writing for the site since 2011. An Atlanta native, he lives in Brooklyn, along with 93% of the other people you read on the internet.
That's fact.
Nikki Berger. Formed Berger Management while a junior at the University of Pennsylvania when he began managing Group Love, which has earned numerous accolades, including a platinum record, a number one alternative song, and three others in the top 10. He's here in Austin with Holy Child, a new artist signed to Glass Note Records, whose song, Running Behind, can currently be heard in the TV ad for Apple Watch. All right. Will Butler. Give a wave. Is an Oscar-nominated composer for his work on the music of Spike Jonze's Her and member of the world-renowned Grammy-winning Arcade Fire. He recently released his first solo record, Policy, and is performing multiple shows at South by Southwest. Wynn Butler is frontman and co-founder of Arcade Fire, one of the most critically acclaimed and consistently innovative acts in modern music. Arcade Fire's albums include Funeral, Neon Bible, the 2011 Grammy for Album of the Year, The Suburbs, and the international number one album, Reflector. Wynn can be seen spinning this week at South by Southwest under his DJ alias, DJ Windows 98. Paul Krugman is a Nobel laureate, professor of economics and international affairs at Princeton University, and writer of an economics and politics blog, The Conscience of a Liberal, for the New York Times, in which he also chronicles his music interest in a series of posts called Friday Night Music. And finally, Tatiana Simonian is VP of Branded Music at Nielsen Entertainment. She's former head of music at Twitter, and most importantly, a musician who believes in advocating for the artists. So thank you all very much for coming out. We're really excited, so I'm gonna hand it over to Rembert.
Hello, everyone. Welcome, glad everyone's here. I'm gonna jump right into these questions, but before I think it's, this is a really funny panel for me to moderate because I failed economics, and which is why I'm the moderator and not a panelist. But we have a very smart, wonderful, charismatic panel, so enjoy this. First question, and we're gonna go, and then at a certain point we'll open up to questions, so I will make note of that. For the panel, and whoever wants to jump in can. The US and many other first world countries are becoming subscription-based economies. We used to call music product. Did the pendulum swing too far in that direction, or is music still a service? Does anyone want to start with that? Nick, you want to go?
Yeah, sure, I can say something about that. No, I actually don't think that music has changed from a product to a service. I think throughout the history of music, there's always been different ways people interact and absorb music, whether it be buying a vinyl, listening through it that way, a tape, a CD, an MP3, and now some intangible thing in the cloud through streaming. And I think that at the core, the music that's being created hasn't changed because of the way that people consume it. And there's always been a service industry running parallel to the music being created, whether it be distribution through record stores, through chain retailers. I don't think anything necessarily is extremely different about that. I think streaming is just another model for people to consume music, and it will continue to develop over time.
Maybe I can just say, I'm a ringer. I don't know why I'm here exactly, but my Princeton colleague, Alan Krueger, actually has done some real work on this stuff, and he gave an economics paper at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, which has got to be a first. And one of the things he found is that things have changed a lot less for the musicians, for the artists, than you might think. That even in the heyday, even at the peak of the CD, you know, when the industry was raking in money hand over fist with CDs, artists earned about 7 times as much from live performance as they did from royalties. it's always been really about the live performance as far as the artist is concerned, and that hasn't changed.
Before I go on, I just want to go through...
There's a lot of music that isn't sold or bought as well, like the vast majority.
Yeah, very true.
Just a thing people make to express themselves.
One of the things I want to talk about, because I think having a panel about the celebrity economy and music at South By is very fitting, because this is one of the places that, in my opinion, I've seen brands and commercialism and music really maybe get to a, I don't want to say terrible point, but like a overwhelming point. So just before I go on, how many South Bys have each of you gone to?
This is my fifth South By.
This is my first for music. I was here for film a couple years ago.
Okay.
This is my fifth.
Okay. This is my virgin experience here.
You know, we managed to avoid ever playing here as a band, but we're just here. We're here now. We made it. We made it.
How do you feel about, because it's so in your face, whether it's through commercials, through walking around this.
The new Sriracha burrito, it's not that good.
Are you on the record for that?
I'm going to go on the record. It did not taste good to me.
I thought it was a quesito. Anyway.
Are you anti the brand takeover of music, and almost it seems like we're getting to a point where it's almost post backlash, like everyone's just kind of accepted, like we can't fight the Beats pill anymore because they're funding every music video, it seems like. Where are you in relation to how you accept like the in-your-face branding of so much music? Do you mind it? Do you just like not care anymore?
Since this is my day-to-day work, I'll chime in. I originally did academic work on globalization in the music industry, and I used to be of the street cred, anti-selling out mentality as an artist, and I learned that street cred didn't pay my bills very well, and or maybe I just wasn't that good of an artist, but I think that the dialogue has changed in a way that brands have also become a big revenue source for artists. But in any partnership, there's a negotiation going on, right? You should be doing a cost-benefit analysis. If you're not comfortable with the terms of that sponsorship, then you don't have to accept it, because they want something from you, probably your cool factor or who you are. And on the other token, you want something from them, right? A revenue factor. If you're someone just attending and you're overwhelmed by branded experiences, et cetera, there's certainly many places at South by Southwest to see emerging artists still. I mean, I've seen plenty while I'm here. I find branded music to be a really intriguing space for emerging artists as well. I was mentioning earlier that Chipotle will have celebrity cards, or they'll give emerging artist cards to get free burritos on the road. When I was a touring artist and I didn't have per diems, I would have been stoked to get free burritos on the road instead of having to eat, you know, walnuts at Flying J every night. So I don't think that it has to be necessarily looked at as this big selling out. It is a bit oversaturated.
It is selling out, though, just for the record.
Well, if you... I guess it's great if you can afford to say that to somebody.
Yeah, you can afford to get a Chipotle burrito if you're managing your tour right, in my opinion.
Well, I don't know.
Actually, can I just, I don't know anything at all, really, here, but I do.
period. But
it's fine, and we do it every day. You know?
One of my employers is in something of the same situation. A business where the digitization and all is making it harder and harder to make money in the traditional way, and the New York Times as a business is basically an advertising platform for luxury goods wrapped in a little bit of news, and you know, you may love those great foreign affairs reporting, whatever, as you should. It's actually T Magazine that pays for it. And the whole question is, how does the institution deal with that? Does it allow itself to be corrupted by that? And we may be a little bit too many page one stories about the pain of being affluent but not really rich in New York, which is the demographic. But I think not at all. So it's all about how you deal with it, not really about where the money is coming from.
Agreed. Well, if I can jump in here, I think, you know, a few years ago, I would have said, I think artists were even, who were starting out, were much more careful about everything they associated with. At this point today, there is an expectation, I think, to a lot of consumers that there's going to be an interaction between brands and artists and music specifically. I think that, you know, for example, you mentioned the Beats pill. If an artist is trying to make a music video and Beats says, hey, you put our little pill in your thing, we'll give you $10,000 towards helping make that video happen. As long as there is a natural organic relationship between the product and the artist and fans can understand why it makes sense to have that integration, in my personal opinion, I don't ever fault an artist for that. I respect the hell out of you guys and the way you guys have done it. And that's amazing you were able to accomplish that. But I think a lot of artists maybe ideally would like to do it that way, but aren't capable of doing it that
way. I mean, I think the example of the Times is pretty pertinent because it's like the ultimate thing is if it affects the thing itself. I mean, that's what I imagine they spend a lot of effort at the Times discussing that exact thing. So ultimately that is the most important thing is that the actual art or the actual thing isn't.
Yeah. Right.
This is not exactly a music conference that we're at.
Right. Yeah. No, but I mean, I personally feel
there
that
is some music here, but that's not the main thing going on.
If the actual art is not informed by the economy outside of that, if the art is made from an honest place, and then once it's released into the public, it's the public, it's their music to do what they wish. Some people might want to put it on and party to it. Some people might want to study to it. If there's an integration that they can make some money and a film wants to license it, as long as the art wasn't actually created from a place where the intention was to exploit it as much as possible and was made from an ardent, honest, artistic place, I believe that, and again, this is a very personal thing and everyone can have their own take on it, but I think it's
just a personal thing.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. My take on it is that I don't care if it comes from an honest place, if it's good or bad. Like, if it's a shitty video with the Beats pill in it, I don't like it. And if it's a good video with a good song, and they're like, I like the Beats pill.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
Shit, I love this song. Right. Then it's great.
You go like, buy a Beats pill.
It's just if the art is good, and it's, you know, it's like, oh, the freaking Medici's maybe paint Medici in the painting. Like, oh, it sucks. You're like, oh, no, it's fine. It's great. Great job, Michelangelo. But
well, on that note, there's always been patron of the arts.
So I'm fine as long as the product is good. And sure. The only shame to me is that it enables so much boring music to be made.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, that's true.
I think there's an assumption that sometimes that all branded partnerships are inherently bad or something. And I think that authenticity is also dependent on you. Like, kind of, in addition, when you sign a major label deal, you've just entered into a branded partnership. And a lot of those negotiations are sometimes worse than deals with brands, you know? So every single negotiation you're making as a professional artist is going to be a branded partnership, right? The authenticity and the execution is going to be up to you on how that plays out.
Yeah. One final note, because we've said the word brand 100 times in the past 5 minutes. But
this panel is brought to you by Chipotle.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sofritas later today.
I do think a shift is happening where artists are starting to get a little bit more power in that partnership where, like, 4 years ago when I started coming here, it was very much like brand X or company X with a ton of money gets an artist to come, and it's very much like artist is working for us. It's like artist like works for us for 2 hours. But I have seen a slight shift where it feels like at times the brand is working for the artist. It's like if brand X brings D'Angelo here, they can't treat D'Angelo like he's a worker for them. Like, they have to just be like, whatever you need, we will do it, because we don't want to put you in a bad mood. We don't want to mess this up at all. And I think that, like, it does still feel like, it always feels like selling out, but I think if there's a slight shift where the artist can get that creative control back, it makes it less bad or less like okay.
Well, the reason people come to this thing is because every once in a while something really cool comes along that people get to feel like they saw it when it was happening, which is an exciting feeling. You know, it's like the first time you hear something great. That's really the point of that was the point of this thing. I think the balance has tipped a little bit,
yeah.
But because I find it very hard to see music here. But that is kind of the reason that people originally came here, because like you hear a band that's really cool you never heard before. It's a cool thing.
Yeah. Right.
I think brands are getting smarter though, and they're realizing that they need to get out of the way a little bit more. I think, you know, a few years ago with that Dorito stage that people literally played in a vending machine.
It's the worst thing that's ever happened.
It was insane. And I think that was the tipping point of people having backlash against these brands here at South by Southwest. And the brands that are doing...
You mean the 80-foot Doritos vending machine?
Yeah. I think that... And
we actually bought that vending machine in Sonora last year.
Production
just
the next
for
floor.
The backstage. Just for keeping.
But I think
Doritos.
The brands that are actually going to, you know, achieve whatever it is they want, which I guess is to have some sort of cool lifestyle association with the bands, is to take a very backseat approach. And, you know, there's a couple of different festivals that brands are now getting involved in, and the ones that are doing it right are the ones that are not really even putting their actual stamp on it. Like, we mentioned, keep talking about Chipotle, but they put a festival all over the country called Cultivate Fest. It doesn't even have their name in it. And Sweetgreen, the salad company, has a festival in DC called Sweet Life Festival. And they're realizing that you don't need to have in-your-face marketing in order to actually achieve what they're trying to achieve. That just create a good environment for people to want to have fun, listen to music, and I know I'm an advocate for the branding here, but I'm just sort of trying to say their side of it is just put people in a position that they're going to enjoy what they're doing, and by association, they're going to have, good thoughts.
Well, it kind of goes back to, Paul's point before, which is that essentially artists have been getting screwed over at pretty much the same rate since the beginning.
Yeah.
And now slightly different people are slightly screwing us over. But even if you're getting paid a couple grand to do a thing, you're really giving more value as an artist than you're actually getting, no matter what you think. I mean, unless you're a totally terrible artist and you just sock it away for the... the college fund.
Just to say, the Elector of Brandenburg thought that J.S. Bach was working for him. And in the end, I think he got a lot of good publicity out of it over a couple of centuries there. So it was a good investment for him.
I'm going to switch a little bit, thinking about, because this was framed in terms of thinking about the future of music and the celebrity economy. Outside of streaming, touring, advertisements, how do you think artists will make the majority of their revenue in, say, 10 years?
That's when I did some homework for this, because God knows, I didn't know why I was here, so I figured I better do something. And I'm here to have a good time, but anyway, and it's basically has always been live performance, as far as I can make out. There was never a stage when anybody but a handful of, and even among top even among very big bands, most still have always made their money from live performance. And there's really no reason to think that that's going to change. I mean, it's become easier and easier for people to get their hands on digital versions. If you want to hear what the songs sound like, it's going to be it's essentially impossible for a band to make money out of people who want that. It's the experience of being in a room and really experiencing it that is where it's going to be. I just don't think that. But the idea is, if you think that that's a change, it isn't really. No. That's the way it's been since time immemorial.
I'm sorry. In 2002, David Bowie gave a quote to the New York Times, and where he talked about music becoming like water. It was essentially going to be free, and that you, no matter what you think about it, you better accept the fact that you're going to have to love touring, because that's going to be the future of what's happening. And since then, as we've seen, issues with copyrights, etc. That's exactly what has happened. You know what I mean? You can essentially get music free now, so artists aren't getting the same revenue, with the exception of like the vinyl world that's had a 6% increase in sales in the past year. For a lot of artists that are in that space, it's going to be things like syncs, scoring, touring, and meaningful partnerships, if they're open to that.
And I think a lot of artists will make money from their parents.
Yes. Wow, this is...
Which is already a giant, I don't know if you know this, but that's a giant way that a lot of bands are around today, is that their parents pay for things. Yeah. And it's great. I mean, that's how me and Wynn bought our first tour van. Their parents bought it for us.
Shout out to parents. They're great.
No, but there's more and more, as the rich get richer,
their kids can do whatever the hell they want. Yeah. And a lot of them are going to be in bands. And it's going to be, you know, it actually seems like it's quite a large percentage is more and more people who are like, oh, even like middle class people who like, and like had savings for college. And like, yeah. Oh, we had more than enough savings. So yeah, you can go on tour for a year. And it that is also an important part. Shout out parents, big up parents, yeah, big wherever up parents. You are.
I'll also add that I do think that songwriting is still going to be an important part of artists' revenue stream. It's always been a business of pennies and or fraction of pennies. And so people are used to that. And as long as people are still listening to music somewhere, which I don't think is going away anytime soon, artists are going to collect royalties. And if you write big enough songs, you write hit songs, that is going to be a revenue stream that people can still make money from down the road.
Just something to throw in, a fact of which I'm still not sure I have my head completely wrapped around. It's what has not changed is that performance is where the money is. What has changed is that we've got a 1% phenomenon on revenues from performance, which is that over the past 30 years, basically concurrently with everything else that's going on, the share of those revenues going to a few bands at the top has massively increased. So just seeing, although it's all revenue, it's all performance revenue, more and more of it is going to just a handful of bands filling arenas. And even though it feels like there's this renaissance of all these small bands and small venues, but they seem to be getting an ever shrinking share of the pie. And I'm not sure we entirely know
and
why
how,
that is.
I mean, that's pretty much related to the rest of society as well.
It might
right?
be. Yeah. It might be the people spending $300 on tickets for you can imagine, for the usual suspects at the top, because there are people who can do that.
Yeah. I just thought about this when you said this, Paul, but I there was a moment last year when I couldn't get to, I can't remember if it was a concert or a festival, and then just like sat in my room and watched the live stream and actually like really enjoyed that experience, and then like got frightened because I was like, wait, is this like gonna be a thing where?
Well, yeah, if it's like 3D goggles and you're
yeah,
like,
I mean they're getting like, no. You know, like I don't know why anyone would ever take a picture or a video at a concert at this point.
I prefer watching basketball on TV than going there, to be honest, because you don't have to watch the stupid big screen. You don't have to. No one throws a T-shirt at you. You can get a drink whenever you want. It's not $40.
Do you think that, like, because so much of what we're talking about is like, well, the performances are still driving this, but do you think that will cut into like the idea of being able to sit at home and watch all of Coachella instead of going to Coachella? Do you think that will then cut away from the performance aspect being the main driver?
I'm talking too much. I think the opposite. I think they're complements, not substitutes. And that's partly my own personal odyssey. I started watching lots and lots of stuff, streaming or as YouTube videos, whatever, and then said, hey, you know, I want to actually be there some of the time.
Yeah.
So I just end up consuming a lot more music, but doing the live stuff because it whets your appetite. Yeah. I think it's actually a positive interaction.
It's an experience that can't be downloaded, and I think as society is becoming more and more separated and fragmented from technology, that people still love to experience something together. And
yeah, I mean, the live thing is always, I listened to a band two nights ago, and some of the songs were in English and some were in Swedish, and I couldn't tell which was which because the acoustics were so bad, but I didn't care. It was a great experience.
I also think it's a great equalizer because not everyone can afford to go to festivals, and not everyone can afford to go to, you know, big ticket shows, or if you're 5 feet tall, to get seats where you can actually see anything. So being able to, so like I stream Coachella, I can't see anything when I'm there. I'm just covered in dirt and miserable usually. So I find it to be a great way to take part in certain things. And I'm sure for a lot of people who can't afford a $350 ticket, that's an awesome opportunity for them to be exposed to a wide variety of music or see their favorite artist.
I hope you're all right. I really do.
Just speaking to the kind of 1% thing, I remember when we were kind of, we started our band in Montreal, and there was actually a lot of like grants, and you used to be able to get money from the government to do art. Crazy, it's insane, but they actually do that. But it was so difficult. Like, as soon as we started to actually have success, then those avenues were really easy. But when we actually needed it, when it would have, you know, at the point when we were a great band, and we could have really used it. It wasn't there. But as soon as we're like, oh, we're good now, they're like, here you go. Here's a touring grant. And we're like, all right, we'll take it. But you know, there is a kind of natural thing that happens where it's like, you know, that a lot of these brands are, you know, the money that they're throwing at emerging artists, it's pretty minuscule. I know it's you know, it's something if you're trying to like not lose money on a tour, but it's like still most of the money is still going to the bigger bands. So it's something that happens. So.
Yeah. Another thing I think is worth discussing is kind of this trend that I can't really pinpoint when it started, but this idea of labels really focusing more on data than just gut instinct. Do you think that, like, again, looking to the future, like, do you think that's a trend that'll continue, if it'll reach a point and then kind of subside? And do you think that's something that helps artists, or you think it ultimately hurts them as time goes on?
Being the person who works at a data company and used to work at Twitter, I think that data is a great informer and a great equalizer. I don't think it should be why you make creative decisions, but it's a great way to inform creative decisions, right? Mm-hmm. So a lot of times you'll see decisions based on, like, my kid likes Katy Perry, let's do this. And maybe that hunch is an interesting way to make a decision, but utilizing data can make it more powerful, right? So if you're an artist and you have the ability to pull data on where your top markets are to route a tour, that's very powerful, right? As opposed to playing a bunch of places where you're not gonna have as big a draw. I find data to be a great equalizer and a great helper, whether you're looking at dollars or something like, for Twitter, the big data fact was monthly active users, right? You're talking about making growth. So maybe it's tracking how you're growing your followers on social media, et cetera. I'm a big, big fan of data, having been an artist who coded and found a way to provide our value outside of money. Because if you're not selling records, how are you communicating, you know, what you do in a certain way? And sometimes data is a great way to provide that value.
I'll just, oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
No.
The kind of flip side of it, though, is that they kind of use, I mean, the most relevant current thing is like using, you know, what is it, like the Spotify plays to know what songs are, you know, to pick up on what's trending as like a single or whatever. And there's a thing, like, I really noticed first going to the UK, there's all these bands that are 17 or 18 and they want to be on the cover of the Enemy, and it's a really high turnover culture for bands. It's like next band, next band, next band, next band. And I think it contributes, like when you pick up something like the week that people started listening to it and that band gets signed and gets sucked into it ends up benefiting the labels way more than it ends up benefiting the artists, because it's like you get them while they're ascendant, you get them at a lower rate than if they waited a year and then signed a deal, they'd be in a trillion times better position, you know. So in a way, I think it always ends up benefiting the corporation or the label. It's more in their interest. I mean, it feels fun for the band, like, oh cool, like we have a hot single, oh we got signed, yeah. But the faster that you increase the time between when you think of an idea and that it's being consumed by mass audience, the less time you have as an artist to actually know what you want to say or be good at performing or have played a shitty gig in Iowa City that was terrible that made you realize something about how you wanted to communicate with people. Or, you know, like there's this, I feel very grateful that we had that opportunity to play really tiny rooms everywhere and just learn how to be a band and like learn how to, like, you know, so in a way, that when that gets accelerated, you end up, like, bands get kind of chewed up in this, you know, taco machine.
Throw in just again, I can cross-cut from another field, which is having these digitization issues. Metrics, even of that data type stuff, actually made a huge difference in the news area, and from my point of view, almost all of it was good, at least to start with. I mean, I remember back about a dozen years ago when I was kind of out a little bit in front on criticizing, what's his name, the last president, and and management's attitude changed when the Times started compiling the most emailed list, which is a very crude metric, but still got an idea that, oh, the readers really want this. That was helpful to know. And, you know, right now it tells you, I mean, they used to think that the prestigious sort of, you know, 1,700-word political TikTok story was what the readers really wanted, and it turns out that while they have to do that, it's not what they want. What it's telling them right now is what the readers want is they want to know about food and health. And, you know, so you're sometimes a little bit alarming. The most emailed article in the history of the Times and probably the world was this thing called What I Learned from Shamu about using animal training techniques on your husband. And that kind of tells you what people really want. But still, I think on the whole, you know, relative to an ideal, it's not great. Relative to the kinds of things that somewhat insular executives might think they should be doing, or might think that the public wants, as opposed to what they can actually find out from the data, is probably a good thing.
Sure, just to piggyback off what both of you were saying, record labels, I think, have their own way of operating. I work closely with two different record labels, one an indie label, one a major label. And specifically those two labels, Glassnode and Atlantic Records, don't really use data as the driving force between to decide what artists they sign. Now, there are other labels, such as, you know, most notably probably Universal Republic, that openly uses data to kind of find what is going to be the next huge single. In some territory, it's trending this or that. They take that song, and they do a really good job of blowing it up and making it a huge song. The danger becomes when people become fans of a song, not of the band. There's no artist development there. People don't understand who they are and what they're doing and what's going to come next. And even if you have a major hit song, if you don't have an album, if you're not ready to be in that position because you haven't played hundreds of shows, that's where sort of leading with that data of knowing what's going to be a huge hit single becomes really dangerous because you just haven't had the time to be a band, as you were saying.
Yeah, I'm not in that when I was talking about data.
No, I understand. The data's really helpful. Yeah. I use it all the time. When we go on tour to know what venues are going to play, you look at the data from how many, you know, fans you have in this, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. No,
I think we are, I mean, I would agree to the extent that I think we're becoming in the music world a bit of a one-hit wonder economy right now, and that's problematic to me because we're not nurturing legacy artists, and they're the artists that may not be selling on the same level as a one-hit wonder, but they're going to last the long haul because they're contributing great music like a Father John Misty, et cetera, and I believe that if you're an artist and you know how to use data, you have the power too. You don't have to like cede it to your label, right? It can certainly help sustain that longevity for you, especially if you're not the top 1%.
For Win and Will, just from the artist side, did you feel, like, was there a point where you could feel people just throwing numbers at you more and more than in the past? Or could you feel that transition happening where people were talking at you more from a data side than just like a gut feeling just from, no?
We don't ever have meetings like
what
that.
What are y'all talking about?
We're like, hey guys, here's our record with all the album artwork. It's coming out on this day. And I'm like, cool.
I remember when Funeral came out, I was like looking at the clicks on the website.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh shit, now we got to really pay our provider bill.
Yeah, Will's our web manager.
I can bring together a couple of things I seem to remember. I watched you guys' 2010 Reading concert on YouTube, and somewhere along the line, you say, rough paraphrase, I don't know what the fuck we're doing here. We've never had a fucking hit single. So talk about band development, which would never have been picked up by this kind of metric.
Right, well, I mean, I don't know. We've been very lucky. We're kind of an exception to the rule in a lot of ways. So when bands ask me for advice, I can tell them what our experience is, but I know our experience has been a little bit atypical. But.
It's kind of has to do with what you were saying earlier, but there is I think just like a lot of the culture right now in the artists on the rise, where it's just like you can become something just by putting your music on SoundCloud. Like on the surface, it feels like it's a lot easier now to just like kind of make it on your own. Do you actually think that's true in this economy? Making it on your own can mean so many different things. Like to some people that can mean being the biggest artist, to other people that could just mean being able to support you and your five or six friends that you go on tour with. But do you think it's easier now to make it on your own than it was, say, 10 years ago? And do you think it will continue to get easier to kind of fly solo?
I don't know. I mean, yeah, I mean, definitely the avenues are there just to be able to upload something. And if it's really good or people like it or it hits a nerve, then it, you know. I mean, we were at the very beginning of that, you know, internet, like, word of mouth thing. And that is exponentially more possible now. I mean, it's not entirely related, but it's really interesting spending time in Jamaica, which, you know, more great records have been cut in Jamaica than, you know, it's incredible the amount of music that came out of Jamaica for this, like, 10-year, 15-year period. And there was no one, until Bob Marley went to the UK, no one ever played live in Jamaica, ever. Like, you couldn't go to, like, a reggae show in Jamaica. It was all just dudes in the studio. You cut a record, the record gets played by the sound system, and people go buy rum and beer, and the better the sounds, you know. So there's different ways that it's happened, but ultimately, if you end up with, like, all this great music, I mean, the economics or the ultimate goal is that you end up with music that's really amazing, you know.
Yeah, I think in general, I think we're kind of in a golden age of folk art of all kinds. Where I think all the stupid internet jokes, I think, is like the most creative era we've ever been in. and I think people making music and making YouTube videos and all of that is part of that. I think as an industry thing, I don't even think about it. I'm just like, whoa, that the industry is so screwy. But in terms of actual creativeness and people making art for other people, even not thinking about making it, I think we're in a really good place holistically. Like, I think in terms of all art, we're in a great place. Music is in less of a golden age.
Yeah.
But holistically, I love everyone.
Pewter age. Yeah. In the pewter age of music.
Keep going.
Well, yeah. I mean, just to say what you were saying here, I agree that the creation of the art part of it is, you know, the ability to do it yourself is probably easier now than it ever was with technology. And with the fact that you can go get a, you know, you can shoot a music video on your iPhone and have it be a pretty high quality. I think that you can go from maybe 0 to 3 in a way that you easier than you could before. But in order to go from 3 to 10, I still think it's pretty vital that you do have partnerships, because the world's a very big place, and getting distribution all over the country, getting radio all over the country, even someone like Macklemore and Ryan Lewis, who are, you know, notorious for not having a record label due to themselves, when they wanted to get their song on the radio, they had to go outsource and get a radio team to go do that. And so I still think that it's very, very difficult. Maybe there's some exceptions still, but having a record label who does have relationships can help guide you if you trust the people you're working with, can still be a very vital and important part of helping to develop your career. I don't think
necessarily. You said 0 to 3. Is 3 a point where you can, like, pay your rent?
I think 3. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe
absolutely
not.
Absolutely not. Do you live in Brooklyn? Absolutely not.
I think 3 is a point where you can have some, you know, like, buzz and things can, people can actually, you can play shows, you have real fans, but maybe they're small clubs. I think in order to actually get past that point, and get to the point where you can make this your career and make this your career, you still do need the help of other people around you.
If you live in Dayton, Ohio, you can pay your rent. Yeah. If you don't live in LA or New York, you can pay your rent. I still have a friend who was until recently paying $75 a month in Montreal. You know, you can, it's pretty easy to, you know, it just depends what your rent is, you know?
It's true. I do think the rent threshold is, like, a legit thing because, you know, like, it's something that most artists are trying to do, and I think it's a fair thing to want, like, not without linking that with compromising your vision and your creativity. I think also wanting to pay your rent is, like, a fair thing.
Yeah, David Byrne did not want to live on the Bowery when he moved to New York, but he had to. It was not that nice then.
Great. Two more questions and then we'll open it up. Are there artists that you think are navigating the industry in very smart, creative ways, whatever that means? Again, like, so much of this is subjective, and I think that's why it's an interesting topic. But in your mind, are there artists that are navigating this world well?
I'll bring up Father John Misty again, partly because I'm obsessed with his album, but I think he's done a really great job. I advise a startup called Vinyl Me Please, and one of the partnerships he did was a partnership with them in advance of his album, where they were able to do a custom limited edition pressing of his vinyl to send to over 10,000 fans. And that means vinyl revenue and maybe exposure to a group of people he wouldn't have been exposed to, but it felt really authentic and meaningful. And behind that is an album that stands for itself and has really great songwriting and took a while to work on. I also think, you know, going on a more mainstream level, Kendrick Lamar has done a really good job. I shared a panel with him 2 years ago where he talked about just, you know, he was a kid who spent 8 hours a day in his garage and then passed out mixtapes, but he always viewed himself as sort of a businessman in a way, and he made really smart, calculated decisions about how he's approached it, and I think that has paid off. And his art and is not compromised.
And the music's really good.
His music is amazing.
Care.
His art is amazing.
But he's put the work in.
He's put the work in.
Yeah, he put in the hours, and it's great. So that's why people care.
Yeah.
But
I think. Oh, sorry.
No, I was. Like, I do think one of the underlying things that it's hard to quantify or explain, but like when the music is good, like a lot of the other things aren't necessary. Like they may get you to that 10 or that 9 that you want, but like
for me it's just a waste of mental energy of dealing with the whole cesspool of the whole thing. You should just be in your cheap bedroom making something that's good. You know, just the when we first started having to deal with the music industry, I had so many less hours in the day. You know, just like the more just hours you have in the day, the better, where you're not just thinking about any of this crap, where you're just thinking about the thing itself, you know. I don't know. To me, that's the advantage of not having a record deal or not even worrying about it, because it really does take care of itself if you just obsessively, like Kendrick Lamar did, I guarantee you, that dude was working a lot. You know, like he wasn't like checking the Twitter numbers of what his thing was. He was like, dude was like working, you know? So it really shows when someone puts that into their craft. You know?
Well, he obsessed over every area though, I felt like, you know, he's an amazing multitasker. This isn't the Kendrick panel, but the new record's good, so you should get it.
No, I think nothing can compete with quality. And that's, you know, if you don't have that, nothing else can, you know, you're not going to get anywhere if you don't make something that's great and people also can, it resonates with people. But I think just two other artists on that point that are doing interesting things in this age, and regardless of what you think of their music, Mumford & Sons and Tyler, the Creator, are two artists that come to mind when I think of people who are doing innovative things and taking advantage of new media and new ways to get their music out to people and have fans interact with them on a very intimate level. Tyler, the Creator, has started, you know, the Odd Future Festival in Los Angeles and Fairfax. There's an Odd Future clothing store. Mumford & Sons have created their own traveling festival. They want to call Gentlemen on the Road that goes all over the world, and it's fans come and experience something with the artist in a way that you can't replicate, you can't download.
Is traveling festival just touring?
No, they actually, so they created a festival in like 9 different cities all around the world, different artists, and they go, and it's their festival, but they curated and put the whole thing together.
Very cool.
I think just people, artists that are doing ways, are doing things to get people off the couch and off the internet and getting people to interact with the music and with each other, I think is, the artists are doing really interesting things.
Great. The last question, I just want to go down the line and then we'll open it up, because thinking about the future, this is kind of, it seems archaic, but it still needs to be discussed. Why, just individually, what makes each of you buy an album?
Versus stream it, or versus
just purchase an album? And you can, if you're just like, I just don't, you can also say that.
So, this is going to be a strange thing. The only album I've ever pre-ordered and ordered was Neon Bible, actually. Because I was such a huge fan of Funeral, and I literally couldn't wait for that album to come out. So I think for me, it's having a connection to the artist beyond their music and beyond, and have it resonate with me in an intangible way. I don't know if that's a great answer, but there's nothing specifically the artist does except create the music that hits me in a way that I
so like this,
can't comprehend.
This idea, really like if you support them, that'll help them make more? Is it?
It was just, it felt good to support something that made me feel so good.
Gosh. I buy a lot out of, but I'm not in a big music phase right now. I'm more in a podcast phase, and that's all free. But I buy, I listen, I buy out of convenience sometimes. Like, oh yeah, I want that. Oh, I'm walking by this world, I'll take that. But I'm not laser focused on new music these days.
I buy sometimes to support the artists directly and help their numbers. You know, when Radiohead did the pay-as-you-go thing, I wanted to support that. I bought several copies of Lazaretto because I wanted Jack White to be number one. My friend Ike was in his band, too, and I wanted to support them and support the vinyl version of it. For indie artists especially, I feel more of an affinity toward buying their music versus sometimes larger artists. Because I feel like it's more important for them. If I'm at a show, though, I'll almost always, if it's a band I haven't seen before, I'll always try to support by either buying merch or an album.
Yeah, every time I find a band I like, I buy the album and then don't listen to it because I almost always prefer the live performances. Yeah. And of course, you can watch those often streamed as videos, or you can find them in some form. Actually, it's illegal, and if someone's about to arrest me, you can't, in fact, download the video, so you don't necessarily have to have Wi-Fi access to watch them again. And the records are almost always overproduced, no matter how. And I know that they're always told, don't overproduce, and somehow. So I actually prefer it, but I feel it is a kind of a duty, because that is still something that matters a lot to a band on its way up, that they be able to sell albums, so I buy it.
I buy music all the time. Just, you know, if I like something, I buy it. Usually digitally, but because my turntable has had a broken needle for like 7 years. But yeah, I mean, I'm really profoundly remember, you know, waiting for the Benz and OK Computer, and I mean, it's like Radiohead and Bjork were the two artists when I was in high school. Like, I bought Post the day it came out, I bought the Benz the day it came out, OK Computer, Kid A, like all those records I bought. I was like waiting for the day it came out, and you know, and everyone listened, we all listened to Kid A at the same time. And so yeah, I mean, it's like artists like that that just are so undeniably great that you just can't even wait to, you know. But it, you know, it's like the Kendrick thing, like people were really excited in any format you could get it, you know, you just to listen to it. So I think that's why, I mean, there's a lot, like I listen to a lot of Haitian music, and you can get a lot of stuff online now that you can buy a lot of stuff that even 2 years ago you couldn't get, like, you know, crazy records from the 70s that are really obscure that you can never find in any record store. So, but yeah.
I also bought Taylor Swift's album because you couldn't stream it.
Oh yeah, not on Spotify. She needed that. If we have any questions, there's a hot mic in the middle. Got about 10 minutes.
Hi, my name is Wei. I'm from Singapore. My question is with regards to data and valuation metrics. So yeah, Tasha and I saw that little smoke. I'm sorry, but this question
is... I'm on a panel with Will Butler and Paul Krugman. You want to ask me a question about data? Amazing.
Yeah, I mean, of course it's relevant to industry as well. But I mean, the whole idea here is that, you know, branded partnerships are on the rise. Data is undeniably, you know, on the rise as well. So corporate brand owners are demanding greater rigor in the data that they receive. And this is very pertinent to the company that you're in as well. And what do you see, how do you see this trending in future? Is there going to be even greater precision? And I'm thinking between impression metrics versus engagement metrics. So likes versus, you know, the power to convert to purchase. Yeah.
So kind of touching on what Paul said before, I think in regards to an ideal, maybe not the best, in regards to informing as a whole, yes. My world doesn't really use impression data necessarily. I can speak to you offline about you know, the way we're measuring brand activation or getting more information about the demographics who consume different genres of music, et cetera. I'm obsessed with the science of how things are created. That's why I love data, right? It's not just because I'm trying to moneyball every system, but does it help to maximize precision? Certainly. Is it going to get you 100% rate? I'd be a millionaire if I could do that in any way, shape, or form. If you know, Next could, Big Sound could predict every platinum artist, Alex White would be a gajillionaire right now, but none of us can get that 100% precision, but it can certainly inform, and I definitely believe that it helps, although not ideal.
Only three-pointers and dunks, nothing else.
So, Paul Krugman, I love your work, read you for years like all of us, but I do think there has been a misconception maybe propagated here today. I'm a music lawyer and a law professor. We represent older acts that maybe never toured, like the Alan Parsons Project, West Montgomery. We represent new artists. One has an album out this month, Sufjan Stevens, and Asthmatic Kitty Records, Foxygen, Cage the Elephant, so newer touring artists. There is a lot of money at stake that is not live touring money. It is publishing money for writing the songs, and it is money from record labels or artists who sell their own records for selling music and hopefully getting more from streamed music like Spotify in the future. I would like to ask actually the Butler brothers if you have seen significant income other than live touring income over the years as you've been successful selling records and writing music.
Yeah, I mean, we were lucky enough to make our record on our own, so we didn't have to sign a deal, or we didn't sign a deal in the UK till after Funeral had been out for a year or something like that. So we had, in terms of our publishing, owning your own, it's increasingly difficult, but I don't think any artist should, if you can own, it's not worth whatever money anyone's gonna give you or tour support to not own your own material. I think that's, but if you really look at it from a raw numbers standpoint, I think we probably, touring is a lot more significant. But
Yeah. I mean, if we had a normal record deal, we would make a lot less money selling records. Yeah. And the touring.
But we have like the best record deal of all time, and still we probably make more from one big festival than from everything combined on the publishing side. Whoa. But I would say, I don't know, that's a rough estimate, but. But if you're representing a lot of artists, you have a lot more income than one artist because you guys are getting a percentage of like 50 artists. Or if you're a manager and you have 50 bands, then it adds up for sure.
I've got a little bit of a corollary question to that, which is about risk capital in music and the future of music. So there are economists like Tyler Cowen who would say that we have a great balance between the copyright system and patronage and grants in this country. And then we have people like Dean Baker who say, no, we really need more direct subsidy of artists. And here at South By, the only people getting direct funding are non-American bands, it seems. So my question is, even though we wouldn't shed a tear for the old record system, the old major label system when they were awash in cash, they were taking a lot of risks on bands where the winners would subsidize the losers. And where's the future of that? Where do we find money so that people can just create art and not worry about the business? Where's that risk? Or do we need more direct subsidy in this country for art? Or do we need stronger copyright?
Well, I think Will may have had a point that, sad to say, quite a lot of it, I think, is being subsidized. The risks are being taken by the bank of mom and dad. And that you know, people with family resources go into it. Most of them don't actually ever make it back. Some of them do. That's not ideal, but I'm not sure that record labels historically did a particularly, you know, broad spectrum job of supporting possible things. So, there's no ideal system. I think the interesting, I mean, Tyler Cowen tends to believe that markets will work even when there's absolutely no good reason to think that markets will work particularly well in an enterprise like this where just about everything that all of the assumptions you make to come up with the idea that markets are optimal is exactly wrong. Doesn't mean that we have an easy alternative solution, but there's no particular reason to think that what we've got is a good one.
And in Canada, I have a lot of friends who make amazing music, who can make a living from it,
and it's awesome. And I have a lot of friends who make really boring music that can make a living from it. And you're like, oh, well, at least you're making a living, but that's okay.
Yeah.
And then, so some, you know, half the time you're like, I wish we were in the libertarian wasteland. And half the time you're like, no, I'm glad you can buy groceries and we can go play basketball in the afternoon.
Cause you don't, I mean, I don't know if it's related, but there is a pretty, the Canadian thing, we never fully directly benefited from it, but a lot of people do. I don't know if it's related to cool stuff, being able to not get lost in day jobs, but I would say it's, you know, it's being gutted. It's almost, it's gone. It used to be that everyone I knew in a band was like, had some kind of little bit of a grant going, but
yeah,
but it definitely takes the edge off.
Hi, this is for Wynn and Will. When you guys made the We Used to Wait video, and it was like the Google Map thing, that was like the most poignant, beautiful moment where like art and commerce met. So like, I wanted to know, for me, it made me feel something, but it didn't feel like selling out because it was creative and beautiful. So I wanted to know, like, how was that experience and like, how did that come about? Was that more on your end or on Google's end?
It was, I mean, that was Chris Milk came to us and he had the idea and we signed on and he was like, Google's gonna help us do this. And that was almost that's like a classic patron of the art situation, some of the stuff that Google does, some of the stuff that Vice does with Intel, where they're just like, here is some money, do what you will. And you're like, okay, do we have to put a logo anywhere? They're like, no, we are good to you.
No. We used to be a free magazine, but now we're a $10 billion company.
So yeah, so that was the director, and we signed on, and we knew that he had the vision, and we met some of the Google creative people involved were really great too. They were you know.
But the specific idea of the maps, we were really excited, you know, because it was basically like this wealth of, like from an artistic standpoint, we were really excited about using that map, integrating the map stuff, because the team that worked on that video, I can't even imagine what it would have cost to make if it was paid for, because it was like all the programmers working on all this maps technology. I mean, I have no idea. I bet it would have been up there. It would have been like a Beyonce video.
Hi, my name is Rachel. I'm from Spin Magazine, and I love all you guys. And Paul Krugman, I read your work constantly, so I'm very excited to see you. But my question is for, it just really addresses the income equality, especially with young musicians who are hoping to be on the come up, especially ones who have, say, like just graduated from college and are hoping to reach a certain point, but say like they're saddled with student loans and their parents don't have the option to get a van isn't necessarily there, or maybe their parents are from like more traditional conservative background. And in a sense, maybe they don't even live like near a major city. What advice would you have for a subset of would-be musicians and touring bands like that? Like, what can they do?
Wow, I mean, if Wynn Butler says he doesn't know anything about has no advice to give, God knows I have none. I mean, you know, I have no idea. I actually don't quite understand how the bands I like are even, many of them are even surviving. I don't quite know how it's done. I mean, but it's, I have no good answers. It's a remarkably tough world out there.
I mean, I would move to a place with cheap rent and a community like Cincinnati. Like, go live in Over the Rhine in Cincinnati, and it's like 30% vacant buildings, but they really care about music. But moving to Cincinnati is really intense, and you also have to have some sort of reserve to move to Cincinnati. You have to have some sort of support to be able to move to Cincinnati. But that's kind of the only option. Cincinnati, I mean, or bust.
I mean, we used to do like 20 shows a month just in Montreal. Like, I think touring for young bands is kind of overrated. You just play if you live in a town where, I mean, the thing that I loved when I first moved to Montreal 14 years ago is that you could play in some weird, burned-out room, and it was some dance show. Like, there were opportunities other than official venues, which to me seemed unattainable. Like, the idea of playing in a venue was like, how do you do that? They're booked a month in advance. How could you know what you want to do in a month? Like, it used to blow my mind. I'd go to Casa del Popolo, it's like the little venue, and like they'd booked it a month in advance. I was like, how do these people know what they're going to do in a month? How could you, like, I'm going to play next month? What does that even mean? So I would just say, like, work within your limitation and just play a ton within a 4-block radius and just write lots of good songs. And it, you can have the, get, the main thing is just the whole 10,000 hour Beatles in Hamburg, play your ass off all the time. That's really the only advice I have. Like, go to a whorehouse and play music 40 hours a day. If you live in Cincinnati and there's an available whorehouse.
Great whorehouses in Cincinnati.
I would suggest being the house band in a whorehouse. It worked for jazz.
I would also suggest.
Anyway, just to say, I have just, you know, now that I try and pay attention, there are bands where people do, in fact, have a day job and they turn it into something really great. So it's not as if, I mean, so I think it just depends on the person.
The Knicks had day jobs in the 60s, like half the team would work in the summertime.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's not, there may be many routes and being, you know, living on nothing in Cincinnati may not be the only way that you can do it. I think it just depends on you.
If you're in New York, you can also nanny for people. Yeah. Nanny for the 1%.
Making money off music is a historical anomaly, though.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think just because I'm about to get the cut, but also just putting lots and lots and lots of good free music on the internet, like, won't hurt, because that's the way so many, just giving people things forever until maybe one day they will pay you for it. We have to go, but I want to thank the panel. Everyone was amazing. I want to thank All Things Go, and thank all of you for coming.
Thank you, guys.